Bess, you is my woman now. You is, and you must laugh and sing and dance for two instead of one.
I was still a student at the Juilliard School of Music in my last year, and I read in a New York afternoon newspaper, evening paper, I think it was The Sun, I'm not sure, but that George Gershwin was writing an opera based on Du Bois Heywood's story of life in Charleston, South Carolina, among black people, and that he would be on the lookout for talented young, well, he didn't say young, talented black singers to sing the different roles. And I said, this sounds interesting. Maybe I can get a little role in this. Came to a point where I had the courage to say, isn't it possible for Bess to sing this song somewhere in the opera? Mm-hmm. I love it and I want to sing it. Mm-hmm. And he said, no, don't be foolish, Bess is a, Bess type, and that's a lullaby. We can't give Bess a lullaby.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, we'll see. That a critic said it was primitive, was difficult for the black community to accept. You cannot compare Porgy and Bess with Beethoven, nor even with Verdi. Those are classical operas, the operas they wrote. Porgy and Bess was a modern opera.
Do you remember, Anne?
Of course I do. How could I forget that?
I said, you know, I'm here, I'm married to a Norwegian, and he brought me here to you for singing lessons.
We decided no singing lessons.
Right.
We'll just be friends.
Just friends.
And I can try to tell her some of the secrets of life in Norway, which I had to learn when I came a few years before. How do you think that plan sounds?
I thought it was great because yes. I needed to learn everything since I was newly married to a Norwegian,
yes.
And you had been married to a Norwegian. Okay. So all the things that I have learned since being married to a Norwegian, I learned it from you.
Oh, good. It was immediately after the end of the war,
yeah.
In Europe. Then some of the Germans had not yet left Norway.
Yes.
Just at that time, the last of the soldiers were leaving. So it was a rather drastic step from America, New yes. York, Baltimore and Washington
yes.
to Oslo. I started singing concerts and in opera throughout Scandinavia and then throughout Europe. Yeah. So it just fitted in perfectly well, and it was not too difficult to make my life here.
Yes, and I think you've done wonderfully here.
Thank you.
Wonderfully here.
Compliments.
As
thank
we
you.
Would say, your mission material.
Uh-huh.
That's what they used to teach us when I was going.
My Danish Porgy. He is white and he is made up black. You see, there he is. What are you going to do? You're in a white country.
Yes.
Where it is possible to get singers who can sing the roles who are white. And there are no black ones. And the chorus has got to be chosen from among the people of this country. You've got to use white people. You cannot hold out if you want to put on a production of Porgy and Bess. You can't hold out and wait to have black singers.
So it was a practical.
Of course it was. Mm-hmm. Nothing else mm-hmm. but a practical. Mm-hmm.
Now look, you go to the National Theatre. And you live in Baltimore, and your parents and your family's there. So the National Theatre is segregated. Mm. This was before Marian Anderson.
Mm.
And you, a 23-year-old, said, I'm not going on. Explain that.
Well, you know, why should we give a performance at National Theatre and only... And restricted to white people. First of all, it was a production of black people, Porgy and Bess.
About black life.
Mm-hmm. And so on. And then I thought, this is ridiculous. I'm not going to find myself in this position. So I said, I'm not singing. I'm not going on that stage and sing. When my father and mother and sisters and school comrades and friends from grammar school and all that can't come in, I'm not going on there.
Mm-hmm.
And they laughed at me, the other people in
yes.
the cast, mm-hmm. and were a little bit angry and a little bit afraid.
Mm-hmm.
Two, they didn't want to lose their jobs, and they said, you have a contract to sing wherever you are sent, and therefore you must do it.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, if I'm forced on the stage, I'll faint in the first act.
Mm-hmm.
And then you must get my understudy to come on.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't like that idea. So then Todd Duncan began to follow.
Morning time and evening time and summer time and winter time. Got your man.
This is beautiful.
Beautiful music.
Beautiful singing.
Beautiful singing.
It's a strange feeling 50 years after.
Can you listen?
It is a wonderful feeling. I don't know whether we're worthy of it.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Are we worthy, you know? It's beautiful. It's beautiful to hear your own 50 years later. It's beautiful.